Good morning. I'd like to welcome you all to Gumtree Presbyterian Church. It's another beautiful day to worship our Lord and Savior. I got to tell y'all this week, as some of our family members were hurting and loss of relatives and their family members, I was so proud to be a part of Gumtree because I heard over and over just thanks for the love and support that everybody poured out, and it made me feel good to be a part of this group, just seeing everything that y'all did for those that had lost loved ones last week. So I wanted to thank y'all for that. It was amazing. God is good, and God has blessed us, and y'all are a truly great, great group of folks. So I just want to say that. Y'all stand up this morning. Let's praise our Lord and Savior. Let's sing to Him. We're going to sing Our God.
Too, and be patient with me. Charles is at New Albany and helping with the communion there, and we're so blessed to have Stephen with us and to bring the message this morning. And we have some announcements as far as Wednesday night. We'll resume our normal activities, and this Wednesday night will be the men's Bible study with the women serving, and of course we're rotating that week to week. And we encourage everybody to be here for that. Sunday school, we're back to God has blessed us, and thank goodness it seems like this pandemic is beginning to calm down some, this phase of it anyway, and we're back to regular Sunday school at 9:30 a.m. And the offering plate, as everyone knows by now, is in the back instead of us passing the plate. And I had a couple other announcements. One, we will have a congregational meeting, and I believe it's March the 6th. It's 2 weeks from today. The deacons have worked extremely hard and have got a budget and everything together. And as a congregation, we need to meet and look over that. And so that will be 2 weeks from today. So I think that's March the 6th. We have a card from the Stevensons. Dear Gumtree family, words cannot adequately express how loved, supported, and cared for we have felt during one of the darkest times. In times such as these, it is so wonderful to know we belong to this family. The visits, calls, messages, food, and prayers all came at perfect times to remind us we were never alone. Thank you also to each person who attended visitation and hospice or the services. How blessed we are to be his. We rest now because Mom does. Bess, Chris, and Jesse. And I have to echo what Adam said. We appreciate everyone and the support that we have here, and we should be thankful for that. At this time, we want to turn our attention to the meditation passage. It's on the screen. It's Colossians 1, 13 and 14.
Call to worship this morning comes from Revelation chapter 1, beginning in verse 12. It says, "Then I turned to see the voice that was speaking to me, and on turning I saw seven golden lampstands. In the midst of the lampstands, one like a son of man, clothed with a long robe and with a golden sash around his chest. The hairs of his head were white wool, like snow. His eyes were like a flame of fire. His feet were like burnished bronze, refined in a furnace. And his voice was like the roar of many waters. In his right hand he held seven stars. From his mouth came a sharp two-edged sword, and his face was like the sun shining in full strength. When I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead. But he laid his right hand on me, saying, 'Fear not, I am the first and the last and the living one. I died, and behold, I'm alive forevermore, and I have the keys of death and of Hades.'" We gather today to worship the one who is the first and the last, our triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. May we worship him together. Let's pray together. Father, as we come into your house today, we come before the one who, like John, we should fall before like dead men and women. We have no right to stand before you. Our sin is ever before us. And yet, Father, we come today rejoicing because you invite us in. Not only do you invite us in, but you invite us in as sons and daughters because of the blood of Jesus Christ shed on our behalf. And so, Lord, we pray that as we gather together, that you would edify us, that you would join us together. But more than that, Father, that you would be pleased to meet with us so that in this time, as we sing, as we hear your word preached and proclaimed, Lord, that we would draw closer to our Savior. Lord, it is our desire to see Jesus clearly, and so we pray that you would be pleased to meet with us. We ask all these things in Christ's name. Amen. Our opening hymn is hymn number 1, "Praise Ye the Lord Almighty." Let's sing together.
Oh, my soul, praise him, for he is God.
For the last several months in the Westminster Shorter Catechism, we've been working our way through the moral law as it has been summarily comprehended to us in the Ten Commandments. And having considered the perfections of God, reflected as they are in the moral law, then perhaps we've seen or begun to appreciate in a new way just how comprehensive the demands of the moral law really are on every area of our lives. If we've taken an honest look into the mirror of God's perfections, then we will have been disabused of any previously held notions of our having kept any area of God's moral law unblemished or any one of the Ten Commandments unbroken. And we must find ourselves ready to agree with the testimony of the Scriptures as it was summarized in our answer just a couple of weeks back, that none of us are able to keep the commandments of God perfectly in this life, but we do daily break them in thought and in word and in deed. And now it's time for us to consider what the old writers called our just deserts. In other words, as those who are guilty of sin, what does the perfection of God's justice require? What is the paycheck that we have earned for ourselves by our sinful thoughts and words and deeds, and now that justice requires be paid? Or as question 84 in the Westminster Shorter Catechism puts it, if you'll bring that up for us now, please, what doth every sin deserve? And the summary of the Bible's teaching, as it's given here in our answer, is every sin deserveth God's wrath and curse, both in this life and in the life which is to come. Now, as we've just seen, we're not talking about sin out here in the abstract somewhere. What does sin deserve? We're talking about the sin that we commit. So the question really is, what do we deserve? Last week we saw that there are varying degrees of sinfulness, that not all sins are as heinous as others, but the other side of that coin is that there are no small sins, because justice requires that the one against whom the sin is committed informs the severity of the crime and the severity of the punishment. We see that reflected, imperfectly, but reflected in our own justice system. I don't have to give you examples, but there are crimes that when they're committed against one kind of person, they're terrible and they deserve punishment. But when they're committed against another kind of person, say a child, that raises the severity of the crime and the just punishment thereof. Now, God is infinitely holy and righteous and good. And every sin is primarily a sin against God. It's a sin against His infinite goodness. And that merits an infinite sentence. Included among God's infinite perfections is perfect justice. And for justice to be upheld, for justice to be unbroken, then every sin against the infinite goodness of God must receive an infinite punishment. And that's why our answer says every sin deserves God's wrath and curse, both in this life and in that which is to come. Now think about this. We are finite creatures. We can never fully pay the price that is demanded by infinite justice. And that gives us a chilling insight into the words of Christ when He speaks about unquenchable fire where the worm dieth not. And when we put sin against an infinite God on this side of the balance, what could possibly be placed in this side in order for justice to be satisfied? What could go there but the infinite wrath and curse of God? Now, a religious person with no understanding of the gospel could step into this conversation and say, look, you've got it all wrong. Because God is good, He decided to give grace to sinners and not justice. But do you understand what you just said?
You've just said that God's grace is unjust. You've just charged God with sin, and this can never be. And if even the most hardened sinner were faced with the logical conclusion of that unthinkable evil, then even he would cry out, "May it never be." Proverbs 17:15 says, "He who justifies the wicked is an abomination to the Lord." And so here we're faced with the greatest theological question, really the greatest existential question that's imaginable. How can God be righteous and justify the wicked? Now, the answer to this question should, and by God's grace it does, inform everything about what we do here at Gumtree Presbyterian Church on the Lord's Day. This is why we gather. The answer to that question is 2 Corinthians 5:21. He, God the Father, made him who knew no sin, God the Son, to be sin in our behalf, so that we might become the righteousness of God in him. That's the answer to the question. That's the gospel in 24 words. He made him who knew no sin to be sin in our behalf, so that we might become the righteousness of God in him. Yes, righteous justice requires that every sin be met with the infinite wrath of God. And you and I are finite creatures. We could never pay an infinite price. But Jesus Christ, who is fully man and is fully God, and is therefore infinitely holy, took our place. And on the cross, he drank down, so to speak, every drop of the infinite wrath of God that our sin deserves, and satisfied God's infinite justice. He upheld the righteousness of God, upheld the law's infinite demands. And as 1 John 2:2 tells us, he himself is the propitiation for our sins. And not for ours only, but for the sins of the whole world. So we're here this morning to proclaim that good news to the whole world, to sinners. And we're here to ponder and to celebrate the infinite implications of that good news for God's people. And over the next few weeks of the catechism, we're going to dive deeper and deeper into the good news of the gospel. We've been in the law of God for a long time. And this morning, just like every morning, we need to face the reality that's before us. If we're unwilling to face and to agree with the bad news, then we disqualify ourselves from being able to receive the good news. But if we're in Christ, we can, with hope in our hearts, say the answer to question 84 in the Westminster Shorter Catechism. So let's do that together now. Question 84 is, what doth every sin deserve? Every sin deserveth God's wrath and curse, both in this life and in which is to come.
Let's pray. Lord, thank you so much for all your many blessings. Lord, thank you as we reflect on what Matt just brought, that through your sacrifice, through your perfect life, your death, burial, and resurrection, that through that we don't have to pay that price that you paid it for us. Lord, thank you so much for that. Thank you for the freedom we have this morning to come together, and for all those that are here. Lord, thank you that the pandemic seems to be waning at this time. Thank you for your blessing in that. Lord, please be with those in the church that are hurting, those that are grieving this week from the loss of loved ones. Lord, from those that are in physical pain and suffering, Lord, please comfort them. Lord, please be with us as we go on through the furtherance of this service. Lord, thank you so much for Stephen's presence here this morning. Lord, please bless him with the words you would have him to bring to us. Lord, please give us receptive hearts and attentive ears. All these things I ask in your name. Amen.
read from Ephesians chapter 2, beginning in verse 12, and we'll read down through verse 20. It says, "Remember that you were at that time separated from Christ, alienated from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made us both one and has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility, by abolishing the law of commandments expressed in ordinances, that he might create in himself one new man in place of two, so making peace, and might reconcile us both to God in one body through the cross, thereby killing the hostility. And he came and preached peace to you who were far off, and peace to those who were near. For through him we both have access in one spirit to the Father. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, Christ Jesus himself being the cornerstone." Let's sing together hymn number 355, "Who is on the Lord's Side?" Catechism question, in light of what Matt has taught us, I'm going to read from Romans chapter 5. It says, "For while we were weak and at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would dare even to die. But God shows his love for us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since therefore we have now been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God. For if while we were his enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more, now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by his life. More than that, we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we now have received reconciliation. You, if you have a copy of God's Word, to turn with me to Luke chapter 11. We're going to be looking at verses 14 through 26 today. As you turn there, just let me say a few things. One, I really am so glad to be here with you, and it's not 9 o'clock in the morning, and I have to race out to go to New Albany. It's really nice to just be able to worship with you and to get to see you and talk to you. Also, we are so thankful that you would loan to us, Charles, to have communion at New Albany today. So thank you, thank you, thank you. We really, really appreciate it. But it's always a joy to be here to worship alongside all of you. So thank you for having us. Let's hear God's word together here in Luke chapter 11, beginning in verse 14. It says, "Now he was casting out a demon that was mute. When the demon had gone out, the mute man spoke, and the people marveled. But some of them said, 'He cast out demons by Beelzebul, the prince of demons,' while others, to test him, kept seeking from him a sign from heaven. But he, knowing their thoughts, said to them, 'Every kingdom divided against itself is laid waste, and a divided household falls. And if Satan is also divided against himself, how will his kingdom stand? For you say that I cast out demons by Beelzebul, and if I cast out demons by Beelzebul, by whom do your sons cast them out? Therefore, they will be your judges. But if it is by the finger of God that I cast out demons, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. When a strong man, fully armed, guards his own palace, his goods are safe. But when one stronger, then he attacks him and overcomes him. He takes away his armor in which he trusted and divides his spoil. Whoever is not with me is against me, and whoever does not gather with me scatters. When the unclean spirit has gone out of a person, it passes through waterless places seeking rest. And finding none, it says, I will return to my house from which I came. And when it comes, it finds the house swept and put in order. Then it goes and brings seven other spirits more evil than itself, and they enter and dwell there. And the last state of that person is worse than the first. The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our God, it stands forever. Let's pray together. Father, as we come now to this portion of your holy and inerrant word, Father, the reality is we cannot take these words and apply them to our hearts in a way that would be meaningful, in a way that would change us. Lord, only you can do that. And so our prayer is that as we gather in this time, that we would not hear the words of a man, we would not hear the opinions of a man, but Father, that you would speak to each one of us. Lord, you know our needs, you know our struggles, you know the places where we need encouragement, where we need a push, where we need to be convicted. And so, Father, be with us now. Do those things in our hearts as you have promised to do for your people. We ask these things in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Whose side are you on? Well, I'm sure that most of you have seen, and some of you may even have, one of those car tags that says a house divided. And so, you know, it might say on one side Alabama, and on the other side it might say Auburn, it might say Florida and Florida State. And of course, in our particular case, it might say Mississippi State and Ole Miss. But the point is whether it's a husband and a wife, or parents and child, or whether it's siblings in a house, the rooting interest, the allegiance to a particular school in that home, it's divided, right? Now, to some degree or another, I grew up this way. My dad, I'm ashamed to say, is an Ole Miss fan, and my mother and I are Mississippi State fans, but he is one of the rare people in this world who can really root on both sides. He can do it without any kind of animosity at all, and so we've been able to make it work because he is that way. Now, I will admit to you that I am not that way. And so I've often wondered if it was two people in a household like me that will not give an inch, that are not willing to compromise in any way, just exactly how that situation might work out. You know, it seems that pretty quickly you might find yourself in a rather delicate position, right? If you said too much either way, whether it was in defeat or whether it was in victory, you might find yourself with a house divided. Really and truly, you might find yourself with a house that is on the verge of falling altogether. Now, I hope I don't have to say this, but I'm going to say it from my own heart, and maybe because I feel like I probably do need to say it. I hope we recognize that is a silly example, and that college athletics should never become such an idol in our lives that it divides us in any way, but much less in our households. But I begin there because that imagery of a divided house, we see where it originates here in the passage before us, right? There in verse 17, Jesus says, every kingdom divided against itself is laid waste, and a divided household falls. Now, we're going to see in the context here that Jesus is addressing a question of his ultimate allegiance. Some, as they so often do when Jesus was teaching, they begin to question just exactly where it is that he stands, you know, whether he is for God or whether he is against him. But the point that I want us to see, and what Jesus is ultimately going to kind of come to as we work through this, is that no matter where we stand, no matter where it is in spiritual matters, whether it's questions of good and evil, forces of God and Satan, there is no middle ground. There is no place of neutrality. As he says here, either we are for him or we are against him. That's important for us to get in our minds at the beginning, because the reality is that as we've already heard, is every single one of us, even now as we sit here, we either belong to the one who has died for our sins, or we are on the other side. We are on one side or the other. And so the question before us is, which side is it? Which side are we truly on? That's the question that Jesus is going to answer, and that's the question that I want us to think about. So let's look at it together. The first thing that I want you to see here in this passage is a question of allegiance. And you see it there in verses 14 through 16. Now, all of this begins, I hope you were following along there, it begins with a short account of one of Jesus' miracles, right? If you know Luke's gospel, you know that over and over and over again, he gives accounts of these miracles. As a physician, we would expect this from him. But his point in the beginning is to show Theophilus just exactly who it is that he's dealing with. And so this is one of the ways that he shows who Jesus is, by recounting all of these different miracles that he's done. But here, it's just a very short one, right? He didn't give us much detail. And obviously, this is not the heart of the passage, but it's interesting to note just how this connects to what Jesus has said earlier in this chapter. And it's interesting to note kind of how this sets up what he's going to say next. And so just look back with me, if you have your Bibles open there, just look back to the beginning of this chapter, and you'll take note that Jesus has been talking about prayer. His disciples come to him there in verse 1, and they say, Lord, just like John the Baptist did for his disciples, teach us how to pray properly. And that's a good request, because another thing that Luke has showed us over and over again is that Jesus prayed. You know, he would go off by himself. He spent time with his Father. And so having seen that, they want Jesus to teach them. And so he gives them there in verse 3, beginning, the Lord's Prayer. You know, it is a guide for us, but it's also a fence for us, Calvin talks about, right? It not only shows us how to pray, but it shows us what is proper for us to bring to our God in prayer. So he gives them that. Then he talks there in verses 5 on down through 8 about persevering in prayer. He tells that great little story about a man who has a friend that shows up to his house and he doesn't have any bread. So he goes to his neighbor's house and he says, give me some bread. And the neighbor won't get out of bed to give him anything. He just keeps knocking and he keeps knocking until finally the man comes and gives him the bread. And Jesus says that's how we're supposed to pray, persistently, bringing our needs over and over and over again to the Father. And then in verses 9 through 13, he gives us just some amazing assurance about prayer. He says, ask and you will receive. Knock and it will be open to you. Now, we don't have time to qualify all that, but that's an amazing statement that Jesus gives us. And so my point is leading up to this, it's been an exposition on prayer, on how we as Christians should pray. And it seems that there in verse 14, he kind of completely switches gears, that Luke just kind of changes course altogether. And that would not be completely unprecedented in the gospel accounts. But I want you to notice here particularly that there's a connection, that it's not a complete 180 from where he's been going. Because what effect there in verse 14 is this demon having on the man that he possesses? He's mute, right? He is unable to speak. He can't communicate with his friends or his neighbors or his family. And we can be sure that this demon, as a servant of Satan, not only is he preventing him from communicating with those people around him, but he's also preventing this man from communicating with who? Communicating with his God. One commentator says that this poor man who is possessed, he cannot even utter those words of the Lord's Prayer that Jesus has just given. Now, the reason I start here is because we need to recognize that always this is Satan's objective in our lives. His objective always is to close our mouths about our God and before our God. He always wants to cut off all adoration, all praise, all worship of the one and true Almighty King. But notice, what is it that Jesus has come to do for this man particularly and for all of his people universally? Well, he's come to set us free, right? We've talked about that. But he's also come to open our mouths in prayer. In verse 14, the evidence that this man was healed was what? It says he began to speak. He was mute, and he begins to speak. Now, Luke doesn't record what exactly it is that he says when he speaks. And so I'm speculating here, which is always dangerous to do. But I think we're on safe ground when we say that if you had been mute for some extended period of time, that if you've been possessed by a demon, and this man comes and he heals you, the first words out of your mouth are going to be some form of praise for that man, right? You're going to want to worship. You're going to thank him. You're going to want to adore him for what he has done. Now, friends, if that is true for this man in our story, yes, what Jesus does for him is incredible. He frees him from the power of Satan in this demonic possession. But friends, if he was ready to praise his king, how much more should you and I be ready to worship our king today? Jesus has saved us, not just from demonic possession, but he has defeated once and for all sin's curse. He has defeated Satan so that every accusatory word he might say to us, about us, is now covered. It's now gone. Christ has taken it all. He has saved us from death itself. And so if anybody has a reason to rejoice, if anybody has a reason to praise, it is those of us gathered in this room today. We know what Luke did not yet know. We know, well, Luke did know at this point, but we know what this man who was healed did not yet know. Jesus would go to a cross and he would die in our place. He would rise again on the third day and he would ascend to sit at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. And he intercedes for us. And he's going to judge the living and the dead, and we have hope because of that. And so we have a reason to praise because God has, through Christ, has set us free. Tongues that were once content to curse him, tongues that were once content to disobey him, he has now set free so that we can praise. And so my challenge here at the beginning is always, may we leave this place, may we go out into the world with Jesus on our lips. May we go out into the world praising him for what he has done, for the hope that he has given us. Now, that's probably a good place to stop, but we're not going to do that. I'm not going to stop there. We're going to keep going. And what I want us to see is that with all of that said, as is usually the case, when Jesus does one of these miracles, there's a lot of different opinions, right? You notice there, some people praise him. Some people are awestruck. They can't believe what Jesus is able to do. But I want you to notice particularly there's two groups there that have seemingly very different reactions, but we're going to see they're really very similar. They're really the same. First, you see there's an antagonistic group, we might call them. It's the Pharisees, the scribes, the Sadducees. There are those people who want to call into question Jesus' character, his motives. And specifically here, they want to call into question his allegiance. Look at verse 15. It says, "But some of them said, he cast out demons by Beelzebul, the prince of demons." Now that term, Beelzebul, it's one that's fairly familiar to us, but it's literally translated the master of the house. It was the name of a pagan god all the way back to the land of Canaan, and it was one that Israel had kind of taken on to convey their meaning behind Satan. It had come to be a name that they had given to Satan. And so with that information, the implication of what these people are saying about Jesus is clear, right? What they're suggesting is that he is able to do the things that he is able to do as a tool or by the power of Satan. Now, for all of us, I hope that sounds blasphemous because it is, but that was their point. They're trying to accuse the Savior of blasphemy at the highest level. And so you have this group that is hostile, openly hostile to Jesus. They're antagonists. We might think of, you know, staunch atheists in our day that want to really downgrade the church, want to talk about Jesus, want to try to prove all that he says is wrong. We might think of other religious groups. But secondly, notice there that there's also this group that we might just call skeptical, right? They're not openly hostile to Jesus per se, but in verse 16, you see that they want to test him, that they just want a few more signs to prove that what Jesus says is true, to prove that who he says he is, he really is. Just want to see a little bit more. Now, as we look at those two groups, it's easy to think that one of them is worse than the other, right? It's easy for us to think that antagonistic group, that group that is openly hostile, that somehow, because they have rejected Jesus altogether, that they are worse than these folks who just have some skepticism. But friends, notice, in the end, both of these positions are really the same. Because what do neither of these groups walk away from Jesus with? They walk into the situation without this, and they walk away without it. It's faith, right? None of them walk away trusting that Jesus is who he says he is. None of them walk away believing that Jesus is the Savior come, the Christ, the Messiah, the Son of God. Neither of them is looking to him as Lord. And so as they walk away, both of them are still lost in their sins. They're still without the salvation, without the Savior that they so desperately need. Now, I think there's a great warning in that to us, to so many people in churches and outside of churches today. Yes, there are those who are going to flat out reject Jesus. They're going to say, no, I don't believe anything he said, and they're going to be antagonistic about it. They're going to be hostile about it. Friends, more times than not, people are just skeptical, right? They just want to see a little bit more. They're just hesitant to believe. I remember several years ago, and this is an old video, so some of you have probably seen it. I think it was made in the early 90s, but R.C. Sproul made a video, and it's for high school students, but he went around to college campuses, maybe high school campuses too, and he asked the question, who is Jesus? Who do you believe he is? And the answers were varied. You know, you had people that were hostile. You had the antagonistic group. But more people than not, just skeptical. I don't know. Or I think maybe if I have more time to think about it, if I have more time to consider, maybe if I see some more signs and wonders, I will begin to believe. Now what was sad and scary about that whole thing was that these people seemed to be pretty comfortable in their position. They seemed to be pretty comfortable in their skepticism. What I mean by that is that there was no urgency. There was no, hey, we got to go learn these things right now. We have to go see if what Jesus says is true. No, they were content to just kind of sit back and wait. Now, maybe that was because they had some dealings with the church in the past. Maybe it was because they had not flat out rejected Jesus. And they thought, well, that'll give me some leeway. That'll give me some wiggle room. Friends, again, what is the point that Jesus is making to us this morning? There is no middle ground. There is no safe position apart from him. Now, he's going to drive that home in what comes next. So let's move on from this point. First, we saw a question of allegiance. But secondly, notice a strong defense. Jesus is going to make a strong defense on his own part, and he gives it in three different ways. First, he's going to point them to the absurdity of the argument that they make, right? He does that in verses 17 through 18. Let me read it to you. It says, but he, knowing their thoughts, said to them, every kingdom divided against itself is laid waste, and a divided household falls. And if Satan also is divided against himself, how will his kingdom stand? In other words, you can kind of see Jesus saying, all right, let's think this through, okay? Kind of like when you approach your kids and they've done something. Let's think this through together. You're saying to me that I'm doing these things, casting out demons, the things that Satan wants to do, possess a man, keep a man. I am doing this on his side. I'm doing this for him. That doesn't make any sense, right? If you watch the Super Bowl, that would be like Aaron Donald saying to Joe Burrow, hey, I'm sacking you, and this is going to be for your own benefit. This is going to help you win the game. Well, that's ridiculous, right? We know that's not true. Well, that's the point that he's trying to make to these people who are talking to us. If a kingdom is divided against itself, then surely it will fall. Surely it will not be able to stand. So the argument is first absurd. But secondly, he also points them to the inconsistency of it, right? Apparently, there are those among the Jews who can do what Jesus has done, or at least claim to be able to do what Jesus has done, which is cast out demons. But the point is that when they do it, what's the reaction? The reaction is joy. The reaction is, look at what God has done through this man and for this person. They rejoice that their people are able to cast out demons in this way. He says, but now I'm doing the same thing, but I do it in the power of Satan. Now I'm the one who is doing it from a bad source. He says, this is inconsistent. He says, your people, they will be your judge. If I'm doing it this way, then surely they are too. And so, you know, the argument is absurd and it's inconsistent, but then he's going to give his own defense by showing them the reality. Showing them the reality. He does it here by first giving them this kind of allusion to the Old Testament there in verse 20. He says, but if it is by the finger of God that I cast out demons, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. That little phrase, the finger of God. If you know your Old Testaments, back in Exodus chapter 8, God has sent the plagues on Egypt through Moses. And you remember, originally, the magicians of Egypt, they're able to do the same things, right? They're able to replicate what God is doing. But eventually, it gets to a point where they can no longer do that. And they say to Pharaoh, surely this is the finger of God. Surely this is the hand of God doing these things. The point is, hey, you better pay attention, Pharaoh. You better look at what's going on. We can no longer do what's happening here. So this is a power greater than we've ever seen. That's the same point that Jesus is trying to make to these folks. He's trying to say, hey, if I'm doing this through God, then the kingdom has come near to you. And so you better listen. You better recognize the one who is standing before you. You better recognize and listen to all that I'm saying. Better bow and worship. Now again, he's going to drive this all the way home there in verse 21. He gives us this little story. And I love it. I love this story very much. And so I want us to kind of work through it together. He says, when a strong man, fully armed, guards his own palace. Now who is the strong man in that story? Satan, right? Satan is the one who is guarding those who are sinful, those who he has kind of under his umbrella, right? He's the prince of this age, Ephesians 2 says. And you can be sure that he's fully armed, that he's prowling around, as Peter says, that he's ready to pounce on whoever it may be. And he wants to keep all of us, as we've already said, away from Christ, away from Jesus. He wants to keep us in our sin and in our guilt. But notice, it says, when the stronger man comes, he attacks him and overcomes him. Now, who is the stronger man? It's Jesus, right? Think back to what we've already seen in the story. This is why I began there with all of that in verse chapter 14. What has Jesus already shown himself able to do? He's overcome this man who was with the demon, right? He's given him his voice back. He's been able to cast out the powers of Satan. He is the stronger man who raids the strong man's house, who takes off his armor, who steals, who takes it back for himself, who takes all of his goods. He is the victor. Now, again, this is great news, because what do we know that, again, this man does not know? We know that victory that Jesus is going to win, it's not limited to just this place, to just this man. But that victory is going to be for all of God's people, for you and I, as we gather today. Jesus is the one who storms the gates, who kicks the door down, and who conquers Satan once and for all, who at the cross, again, takes away every accusatory word, who takes away every sin because he takes it upon himself. He doesn't just sweep it under the rug and say, we'll worry about that later. He takes it and he takes the punishment that it deserves. He is the one at the empty tomb who has defeated death forevermore. Friends, again, this is great news. As we stand by the graveside of a loved one, and I understand that some of you have done that this week, as we stand next to that place, what is our hope? Our hope is that Jesus has won the victory. Our hope is that sin no longer reigns, that Satan no longer reigns, but he does. When our lives are overcome with temptation, when we feel that we are pressed on every side, what's our only sure ground? What's our only hope? It's the King. It's Jesus ascended to the Father. When we're loaded down with the guilt of sin, when Satan is still poking at us saying, how could you have done that? What's our hope? It's not our good works. It's not the fact that we have given up all of those things, because none of us will do it this side of heaven completely. No, our hope is that Christ has died and he is raised again. Jesus is the stronger man. He is the victor. Now, with all of that before us, our question still stands before us as well, right? We've seen the reality of who Jesus is. He has given his defense, but the question still stands. Whose side are you on? Are you for him? Are you against him? Well, in case we think that we can sort of ride the fence, that we can sort of stand on the sidelines and just watch it all pass by, thirdly and finally in this passage, I want you to notice that there is no neutral ground. And we've said that over and over again, but it's worth harping on one more time. There's no neutral ground. Notice the statement in verse 23, whoever is not with me is against me, and whoever does not gather with me scatters. Christ makes it clear here. There is a war raging. There is a spiritual battle that we must all face. Friends, we must have a side. Whether we want to or not, we all have a side. Now, some will reject him. They will call him a liar. They will call him a lunatic. And in so doing, they will choose their side. Some by faith, they will cry out to him in repentance. They will look to him as Redeemer and King, confessing that he is indeed Lord. And they will choose their side. But what about those skeptics? Those who are waiting, those who are showing up to church, who are going through the motions, those who are still maybe looking for some sign. Well, friends, the truth is they have chosen their side as well. Hear me now and hear me clearly. If you're asleep, if you've checked out, check back in just for this, just for right now. What Christ is saying to us as openly as he can here is there is no safe haven. There is no neutral ground apart from him. He who is not for me, he who is not resting in his finished work, is against me, lost with no hope for eternity. Friends, you may think that somehow you can clean yourself up, as the person does in verses 24 through 26. That by sheer willpower, we can run out the demons in our lives. That we can overcome those sins that have plagued us over and over again. And for a time, it may seem that we can do that. And that maybe we can sit on the throne of our own heart. We can be the master of our own little universe, right? But what's the reality in verse 26? Says, if that's the case, the state of that person eventually would be far worse than what it was before all the cleanup ever happened. Because the fact is unless Jesus sits on the throne of your heart, unless he is the king, unless he has made you clean, you will not stand. You will not be able to stand in that judgment when it comes. And so as we conclude, if you're here today and you've been waiting for whatever reason, if you're here today thinking that you have plenty of time to decide, to look for another sign, to look for Jesus, to give you one more thing so that you'll be sure. Friends, if you're here today and you have flat out rejected him at some point in your past, can I plead with you? Put down your weapons, as it were. We're in a war. Put down your weapons. Let go of the doubts, of the skepticisms that often plague us. As Elijah says to Israel in 1 Kings chapter 18, how long will you go on limping between two opinions, between two sides? Let's get off the fence and fall at the feet of Jesus. The good news that we've heard this morning already is that no matter how loaded down you may have been with sin when you came through those doors, he knows it far greater than you do. He knows the reality of your hearts. And yet the truth of his word is that he invites you to come. He invites you to come just as you are. He's not going to leave you that way. He's going to clean you up. He's going to give you salvation, life, eternal life. But he invites you to come. Loaded down as you are, loaded down with sin, loaded down with guilt, loaded down with the worries of this world, and to fall at his feet empty-handed and to believe in him today. Friends, I ask again, whose side are you on? Will you trust in Jesus? Let's pray together. Father, as we consider these things, the reality is that our hearts, they are loaded down with sin. Even those of us who know you, even those of us who are resting in you, we see the truth of who we are. Our sin is ever before us, as David says. We need a Savior. We need someone who will do what we could never do. Take away that sin, take away that guilt once and for all. And how we rejoice that we have that Savior in Jesus Christ our Lord, the stronger man who has defeated Satan, who has defeated guilt and sin and death itself. So that we might now today say, we have hope. Father, I pray if there's anyone here who does not know that truth, who is not resting in that truth, that you will not give them rest until they are resting in Christ. Lord, we do. We rejoice. We praise you because of what you have done for us in him. And we ask all of these things in his name. Amen.
Let's stand together. We're going to sing hymn 369, How Firm a Foundation. Let's stand.
More can he say than to you. pray together.
Father, as we leave this place, we pray that you would go before us. We pray that you would bless us and keep us, that you would make your face shine upon us and be gracious to us. Lord, that you would lift up your countenance upon us and give us peace through the Father and through the Son, through the Holy Spirit. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.